So, yesterday we talked about bagging. So, bagging is very similar to the decision tree that we looked at. The only difference is bagging. In bagging, what happens is, so in random forest, what we are doing is we are randomly selecting some variables, and based on those variables, we are creating some decision tree. So likewise, we are creating hundreds of decision trees. And then once we create hundreds of decision trees, so for example, let's say in this case, let me open random forest as well. So in random forest, we looked at this Boston dataset, which is the housing prices dataset. So let me print the data set itself. Hopefully it will run. Yeah, it went through. So let me print out the names. These are the variable names, which means the columns. Always remember variables are columns, observations are rows. Whenever I say observations, you should remember it is a row. Whenever I say it is a variable or feature, both are same, variable or feature, then you should remember it as a column. So these are the columns or the variables, or in other words, you can also say it is a column, sorry, a feature. So these are the variables that you have in Boston dataset. What we do is we randomly pick some of these variables, let's say crime, NOx, and tax. Let's say we take only three variables randomly, and these are the three variables. One is crime, another is age, another is tax. So in random forest, what we do is we take randomly few variables, and from those variables we create a decision tree. So we build such, how many trees we'll build? Likewise, we'll build n number of trees. We can either build maybe thousands of trees. That is also fine, as long as your machine is capable. So every time you build a tree, you randomly pick some of these variables, few of the variables, and then create a tree. So what happens is that will become a weak learner. And weak learning is something that I briefly described earlier, initially. Weak learning is something where you have your sample space. This border that you have, that you can see here, is a sample space. And from this sample space, what we do is we randomly pick, just a second. Just give me a second. I'm sorry. Yeah, let me continue. So what we do is from this sample, we try to randomly pick some variables and create a tree. And that tree is not going to do very well in this circular region. So there is second tree which doesn't work very well in this region. There is a third tree which doesn't look very well, doesn't predict very well in this region. This is your entire sample space, and these are the samples that this decision tree 3 is not working very well. I mean, predicting very well. Similarly, decision tree 2 is not working very well here. Decision tree 1 is not working very well here. So now the question is, what is the combination of, if you take a combination of prediction of all these trees together, then how much does it not work very well? So the idea is, if you have overlapping regions like this, then the only place, if you take a voting, let's say there is a prediction one from here, prediction two, prediction three. I want to have only one prediction out of all these three trees. What I should do? One way is having a simple voting, majority voting. So what happens is, if two or more decision trees are not doing very well in some region, then my prediction will be wrong. So where do my predictions go wrong? If you see this red region is where my prediction will go wrong. Why? Because this red region represents two or more trees are going to give a wrong prediction. So because of this, voting, when we are voting, there is some area where you are getting a wrong prediction. But the question is, how much wrong it is? So individually, one is looking at this much area. But if you collectively look at 1, 2, 3 together, where 1, 2, 3 together will go wrong, collectively, there is only lesser region. If you see 3, 3 is a very, very big big chunk. But still, 3 together with 1 and 2, it is only predicting wrong in this region itself. So which means, individually they may not be very good, but collectively when you take all these trees together and you do a majority voting, then because each tree is a classifier, each tree will give you some output, some class. If majority class is what I have to predict, then I'll get a lesser error. This red region will keep on reducing as and when I increase the number of trees. And that is what I need here. So what I am doing is, individually these are not very good classifiers, which means they are weak learners, but collectively they are a better learner. They're doing much better. So that is the idea I am going with random forest. What I did is, in random forest, I take some of these variables randomly and build a tree. And that will become my weak learner, because it will be expert in only few areas. It may be expert in crime, age of the house, and then tax, property tax. These are the only areas the first tree is good at. All the other areas like LSTAT, PT ratio, all these different variables, that first tree is not very good at. Then you build another tree by taking again another random subset of the center variables. Next time the random subset may be zone, NOx, and LSTAT. The second time, these are the variables that it might look at. Third time, it may be completely different. So what you're doing is, you're randomly picking some variables, creating one tree. Again, randomly picking another set of variables, you create another tree. Likewise, you create thousands of trees. As long as your machine is capable, you can increase the number of trees. That is very good, actually. If you can increase the number of trees, it will be very good. But it depends on the capacity of your machine. It should not happen that the building training itself will take, let's say, for training itself, it takes like 1 year. It is a useless model. If training takes only 15 minutes, it is good. So you should take care of how much time it takes training. You should adjust the number of trees accordingly. So based on this, you create a lot of trees. Each tree will have its own prediction. what you do, you combine all these predictions by doing a majority voting. Whichever tree is giving the majority class, class is getting predicted by majority number of trees, that class is what you should predict. And all these are taken care by a simple class called random forest regressor in case of regression, random forest classifier in case of classification. Now the same thing can be applied to bagging as well. How do you apply it to bagging? That is also very simple. Instead of random forest, you should use bagging. Only thing is, bagging is a meta algorithm. It's not a true algorithm. What does it mean by meta algorithm? Meta algorithm means, meta means it's not a real one. It's on top of something. What is that on top of something? You should use some base algorithm like decision tree classifier and wrap it around another meta algorithm like bagging classifier. So what I'm doing here is, I'm creating a bagging classifier and I'm creating a decision tree classifier and I'm giving the decision tree classifier to the bagging classifier. Now what does this bagging means? First of all, what is this bagging classifier? Bagging is very similar to decision tree. The only difference is, instead of randomly picking some variables in random forest, that's what I'm doing, randomly picking up some variables. Instead of doing that, what I can do is, I can randomly pick the observations. What does it mean by observations? Observations is a row in your tabular data. So let me print that observations first of all. So observations means each row. Variables or features. If I say variables or features, you should remember columns. So I randomly pick some observations, which means maybe observation 1, observation 4, observation 15, observation 20, something like that. I pick randomly. Every time I pick something like 60% or 70%, I can give that value. But every time I can pick some set of observations randomly and build a tree. Likewise, I build this kind of a tree again for thousands of times. In this case, I think I built only 50 times. Is that right? N estimator is equal to 10. I built only 10 times because I have to do all this grid search and all those things. It will take a lot of time if I build 1,000 times. Okay, that's why I built only 10 times, but try to build the number of give the number of estimators as much as possible, as big as possible. If you the more number of trees that you build, the better it is. So what you do in bagging? In bagging classifier, we pick randomly some observations from this entire data set, and for every random pick you build a decision tree. So you build hundreds of or thousands of such decision trees, and then each decision tree is going to give you some output. What you do is, for classifier, you take a majority class. Same thing. The only difference is, random forest classifier and bagging classifier, both are same. The only difference is, you are picking observations randomly. But in Python, there is a special provision of giving max features, which means bagging classifier also does some of the things similar to the random forest also. So if you pick maximum features equal to 3, what happens is, at a time, for every decision tree that it is building, it will pick 3 variables or 3 features at a time. Which means, this is in Python, what happened is, they built a bagging classifier which can also work like a random forest also. the only difference now is bagging classifier is also picking up observations randomly and variables randomly. Because of this, bagging classifier is working much better. In general, it is working very well compared to random forest classifier. But there are better models also. The other model is called boosting, which is what we are supposed to learn today. Are you clear, Abid? I described all these things just for you.
Clear. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So in bagging classifier, like I said, bagging is a meta algorithm. Bagging doesn't do anything by itself. So what we should do is, to bagging classifier, we should give some base estimator. What is this base estimator? For every tree, tree that you build, what is the classifier that you have to use? So we are using a bagging classifier, and the base estimator is CLF. What is the CLF? CLF is an instance of decision tree classifier. So meta, the reason we call it as meta algorithm is because bagging classifier by itself, it doesn't do anything. It doesn't have any machine learning algorithms. All it does is it will give randomly some values and build this base estimator. In this case, n estimators time number of times. So in this case, it is building the base estimator 10 times. That's all it will do. And finally, whenever there is a prediction, it will do a majority voting. These are the only two things that this bagging classifier will do. But the machine learning, the real machine learning, is not done by the bagging classifier. You have to give some base estimator. And the base estimator in this case is decision tree classifier. You can, theoretically, you can give even logistic regression or any other algorithm. But this ensemble models works very well for only weak learners. It may not work as well, as good as decision tree for other models. So logistic regression is not a weak learner. So because of that, it may not work very well if you pass in logistic regression classifier here in the base estimator. It doesn't mean that you should not pass. You can still pass it, but it will not work as good as decision tree. So is this clear? This is all recap of what we done till now.
Yes, Sandeep.
So that's about bagging. Now we should learn about something called boosting. Boosting is also another kind of meta algorithm in machine learning. And again, this meta algorithm means it doesn't do anything by itself. It will build multiple trees. All those things are there. It might take randomly some subsets. All those facilities are there, but the real machine learning is not done by the boosting. You have to give some proper algorithm to do boosting. Proper machine learning algorithm. So which means, again, you have to give some weak learner. Again, it works. Bagging and boosting, both of them works on weak learners. It doesn't run on any strong learners. So again, it works very well on decision trees compared to any other form of machine learning models. So it works only on weak learners. Doesn't mean that you should not give any strong learner. The only thing is, the final results are not so encouraging for any strong learner. Always use a weak learner on any of these ensembles. So bagging and boosting and random forest, all of these three are combinedly called ensemble models. What it means is, simply, you create a lot of models and take a majority voting. For classifier, always take a majority voting. For regressor, it will take a simple average. That's how ensemble models will work. So for example, if I take a dish entry classifier and bagging classifier, this bagging classifier, what will it do? It will take a majority voting. But if you consider random forest regressor, this is a regression model. So in regression, the output is always continuous variable. So for every tree, there will be some continuous output. So what random forest regressor will do is, it will take an average of all these trees, average of all the predictions of all the trees, and finally predict that average as the final prediction. So in all of these things, random forest, bagging, boosting, you know, all of these techniques, the only thing that will happen is it will create a lot of trees and it will do a majority voting if it is a classification technique. It will do a average out average value if it is a regression technique. So all these can be used for both classification and regression. How the output will be considered is different. Is that clear? Is this clear? You should always remember that regression and classification can be done with any of these techniques.
Yes,
okay. So now we should look at boosting. Boosting is the final ensemble method that we can look at. And in boosting, there are many techniques. Boosting is not one technique. There are a lot of techniques. In bagging, there is only one technique, which is just a majority voting when it is a classifier, or average when it is a regressor. That's how it will combine the output of multiple trees. Now, in boosting, there are multiple techniques. One is called AdaBoost. The second one is called gradient boosting. Third one is called extreme gradient boosting, and this is called XGBoost. In short form, it is called XGBoost, and this is the most powerful algorithm till date on machine learning. In machine learning, XGBoost is the most powerful algorithm. But unfortunately, this is not part of our course. In case you need, like I said, if you need to understand this, I'll give you some extra class whenever it is possible for me. But again, this is based on your interest. If you ask me, I'll teach. Otherwise, this is not going to be taught. So gradient boosting and extreme gradient boosting are based on simple concept. It is nothing but our, if you remember our earlier discussion, it is dependent on gradient descent algorithm. The exact specifics I am not teaching now. And AdaBoost is nothing but, it is also called adaptive boosting. Actually, Ada is not a name. Ada means adaptive boosting. So there are multiple techniques to do boosting. So most popular is AdaBoost, gradient boosting, and XGBoost. So let's understand now about AdaBoost, which is adaptive boosting. So what is this boosting, first of all? So in bagging, what we did is we created multiple trees. Each tree gives some prediction. And what we do is we get an average of all the predictions in case of regression. Or in case of classification, what we do is we take a majority voting. That's how we are doing bagging. But the question is, we are building a lot of trees. Why not learn from the mistakes of the previous tree? So for example, you create first tree, first dish entry, and that first tree is doing some mistakes in some of the training samples. You gave 100 training samples. Out of 100 training samples, 90% or 90 samples, it is doing very well. But 10 samples, it is not doing well. What you do? In bagging, you're not learning from your mistakes. But what boosting is saying is, why not learn from your mistakes? You created one tree, and in that tree, you did 10 mistakes out of 100. Why not learn from your mistakes of 10 mistakes in those 10 models and create another tree? Again, you do another set of mistakes in the second tree. Again, learn from your mistakes of from the second tree and build a third tree. Likewise, if you build 100 such trees or 1000 such trees, your model will keep on increasing. Your model will keep on improving. Now, in the 100th tree, you do lesser mistakes than any of the 99 previous trees. So the final prediction, what you do is, you take an average or some kind of a weighted average of the predictions from all the trees, where the tree where you are doing a lot of mistakes, the weightage is less. The tree where you are doing lesser mistakes, the weightage is more. If you do like that, your prediction will be much, much better than any of the techniques that you have ever seen till date. And that is the idea of boosting. So the idea, yesterday I was giving some example. Let me give that example again. The idea is like this. There is student 1, student 2, 3, 4, and 5. You have students like this. And these students are these are all kids. So they are being taught elementary mathematics. In fact, it is elementary multiplication. So you are asked to, so you started asking what is 7 into 8, 8 into 9, all those kind of basic mathematics. And you are asking each of these students the answers for that question. So you taught how to multiply to all of these students. Or in that case, you can also say that you're just teaching addition. You're not even teaching multiplication. Yes, simply you are teaching how to do 4 plus 5, 3 plus 4. Very simple basic mathematics, arithmetic actually. So what happened is, at the first instant, you gave a introductory class how to add, then you asked each of these guys to answer some questions. So the first person answered the question, second person did not answer the question, third person answered, fourth person answered, fifth person did not answer. Fifth student did not answer. Now what you do? In general, what we generally do in teaching is, if someone doesn't understand some of these concepts, what we do is we increase the attention to that person. This person is getting more attention than any of the other person. Similarly, this person is getting more attention. Initially, when you start a class, you do not know what is the performance of each person, each student. Initially, what you do is, every student will get equal attention. Every student will get equal attention. Now, there are few students who are lagging. There are few students who are doing very good after teaching one class. What you do? Whoever is not getting able to answer the questions will start getting more attention. These two students are getting more attention now. Now, whoever is answering properly, they'll start getting lesser attention. The square box means lesser attention for now. Now these three people are not getting, I mean, they're getting lesser attention than the previous class. Compared to the previous class, now they're getting lesser attention. Attention doesn't mean that they don't like them. It's only that you have a finite amount of energy that you can spend on the class, and that energy is little bit diverted towards these two people. These are also, I mean, I need to teach these three people also. Only thing is, I don't put more pressure on teaching to them. I put my most of my effort will go to these two people. Now, what happened is, in the second class, again, I'll write 1, 2, 3, 4. In the second class, what happened is, because you are not giving enough attention, earlier the third student is doing very well, but because he is not getting enough attention, what happened is, he is not able to answer. You are not giving enough attention to three that he needs. That's why three is not able to answer your question. Four is able to answer your question. Five is also able to answer your question. Maybe even after giving extra attention, two is still not able to cope up with the subject. So he is still not able to answer the question. And let's say one is still okay. Even with lesser attention, one is able to answer the question. So the second time when you do the same class again or different class, what happened is, now three is a new student who is not able to answer your question. Two anyway is still not able to answer the question. Again, what you do? You increase your attention on two and three, and on 1, 4, 5, you decrease. Why do you decrease on 1, 4, 5? Because you have only finite amount of energy. You have only X amount of energy. That energy only you have to spend. You cannot spend more energy than what you have. So whatever energy you have, you divert your energy to these guys. Okay? Again, you'll take another class. Because you increased your energies on 2 and 3, probably this time, hopefully, all of the people, all of the students are able to understand your subject very well. They are able to answer. So in this example, I just gave only three models. This is model 1, which did not work well for 2 and 5. This is model 2, which did not work for 2 and 3. This is model 3. And in model 3, what happened is, all the students got enough attention during the training. They are able to understand the subject very well. And now in reality, this is the same thing that we apply in any of the teaching models. We try to give a little attention to the person who is not able to answer the question. If you give extra attention, hopefully he'll be able to succeed. But what is the further complication you get is, there may be a person who, because of not getting enough attention, he is now lagging. Earlier he is okay, but because now he is not able to get the attention, he may not be able to cope up with the training. So what you need is, you again have to increase. Likewise, you have to build hundreds of models in decision trees. Each model, model 1, model 2, model 3, assume that these are, instead of training or teaching models, these are machine learning models. Now each machine learning model will try to give extra attention to some specific examples or specific observations, and lesser attention to some other observations. When you do this, what happens is you'll try to adjust what is the level of weightage that you need to give to each training example or training observation, and finally you'll just, all you do is just adjusting these weights. That's it. In boosting, the only difference is instead of building hundreds of trees without adjusting the attention or weightage that you need to give to each of these training example, in bagging you are not doing that. Instead of doing like that, here what we do is you start adjusting the weightages. At some point, all these weightages are at optimal level, which means you are able to predict properly about all these training observations. So are you guys clear with this example? What is this boosting? Yes. What we do is boost. Boosting is nothing but boost the observations which are not doing well. Boost means you give more weightage, more attention. So Abid, are you clear?
Yes, Sandeep. Yeah, this example is clear.
Okay. Now that's what we are going to do now. What we are going to do is we are doing something called adaptive boosting. Adaptive boosting is nothing but whatever I described right now. You keep on changing the weights. You keep on changing the weights on each observation. Now one is not a student anymore. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are not students anymore. They are training observations. Observation means one record, one row. That's what I mentioned, right? So in boosting, what happens is you run through the all the training examples and build one tree, one decision tree. Okay. Once you build a decision tree, you try to do predictions for observation 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, whichever observations we are not doing very well, which means our predictions are wrong, we mark it like this and give it some extra weightage somehow. Some formulas are there. Don't worry about those formulas at all. Using some formulas, I'll increase the weightage of the observation for which we are not getting proper prediction, and decrease the weightage for the observation for which we are not getting we are getting proper answer. So for 3, our weightage will be decreased. For 2, the weightage that we give will be more. But initially, what is the weightage? Weightage is same for all the observations initially. We start with the same weightage for all the observations initially. But over the time, what happens? We keep on changing the weightages. That's what is called adaptive boosting. And gradient boosting and extreme gradient boosting are also on similar concepts, but the underlying mathematics is completely different. All you have to do is changing the weightages only, but how you change the weightage is different. So let me open ADA boost. So this, just remind me at the end of the class, I'll upload this Excel sheet to your drive. But for now, let me delete all these things and try to rebuild it for you. Once again. Okay, so how to do this ADA boost is our question. So this is your data set that we are going to work on. The data set is very simple. It's a, it's a synthetic data set. Synthetic data set means we created it manually. There is no real data set like this, but this is a manually created data set, synthetic data set. Now, For understanding many of these concepts, it's always good to have a synthetic data set, but you have to apply finally to some real data set. Now let's try to understand how to do boosting. Just 1 second. Yeah. So what we do here is, so there is a credit which is ABC. This is a credit rating. A means very good credit rating. B means kind of very good or moderately good. C means not very good. It's bad. Bad credit history. So that's what credit history means. Now income, there is H and L. H means high income. L means low income. Now based on this credit and income, we have to predict whether it is safe or risky to give the loan. Again, the same loan kind of a example. Now based on credits, credit history and income, we have to predict whether it is a safe loan or not. Now, how many observations are there? From 2 to 12 we have. So 11 observations are what we have. We have 11 observations. Now from these 11 observations, we have to give proper weightage to each of these examples so that our model will be perfect. To do that, what we do is, let me give the tree that we are going to build. ADA boost example. So for this ADA boost example, the tree that we are going to build is, anyway, in any tree we are going to have some root node, and from this root node we are going to use income, or let me not use the root node, it is all confusing. Let me directly use income. On income, I want to split this data. Income equal to high, income equal to low. Now I want to do this and then predict whether it is a safe loan or risky loan based on this income. For simplicity, I am building only on income. I am not building on credit. Otherwise, I have to build another level of tree. Since I am another level of tree, I have to build and say on credit, if I have to split credit equal to A, B, C, I have to do the split and then create a full tree. But the thing is, I am doing everything manually. So because I am doing everything manually, it is very difficult for me to do everything for boosting. So there are a lot of steps to do in boosting. So if I do manually, it will take a lot of time. So that's why I'm doing everything for only one step, one split. Second split I am not taking. So now on income equal to high and low, I want to split the data. How do I split the data? In Excel, I have to just select only H. So how many safe loans are there? How many risky are there? 3 safe and 1 risky. 3 safe, this is safe loans, 1 risky. When income is equal to high, I have 3 safe loans and 1 risky loan. Now when income equal to low, how many safe loans are there? How many risky loans are there? I have to write here. How many safe loans are there? 3 plus 1, 4. 4 safe loans. And 1, 2, 3. 3 risky loans. Now, this is how I am doing all these decision trees till now. Is that fine so far? How I splitted the data?
Yes. Yeah,
now anything that comes here, what is the prediction I have to give? The majority class here is safe loan. So the prediction will be safe. Yes or no?
Yes.
Now similarly, what is the majority class here?
Safe loan.
Again safe. So whether I go here or here, I'm predicting safe loan only. Okay, that's how I can do the prediction. Now the thing is, there is a slight variation here. Instead of mentioning the number of safe loans, I will do the proportion of safe loans that are coming here, the proportion of risky loans that are coming here. How do I do that? So what I do is, instead of giving either number of safe loans, number of risky loans, I'll give some proportion. Proportion means some percentage value. How do I give this percentage value? For that, what I do is, I'll do something called normalization. What I do is, how many observations are there? 11 observations are there. So I told you that initially I'll give all the weightages are same. Initially, for the first tree, all the weightages are same. So what I do is, I'll give 1/11 as the weightage for 1/11 as the weightage for first observation. Again, 1/11 for second observation. All these are going to get the same weightage initially, which is nothing but 1/11. 1/11 because there are 11 observations. For each observation, I want to give equal weightage. That's why I'm giving 1/11. Now, instead of saying 3, when income is equal to high, instead of counting the number of safe loans, I give the percentage of the safe loans. How do I give that? I just add up the weightages of all the safe loans. So what is the weightage of all the safe loans? If you see at the bottom in the Excel, I can see sum equal to 0.2727. So instead of saying three safe loans, I give the weightage for the safe loans. 0.27 is the weightage that I get for the safe loans. Similarly, instead of saying one risky loan, I give the weightage, overall weightage of the risky loans. What is the overall weightage? 0.09. So instead of giving 3, I am giving 0.27. Instead of giving 1, I am giving the corresponding weightage of the risky loan. Is it clear so far? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, indeed.
So similarly here, instead of giving 4, I should give some percentage value. So when income equal to low, safe loans, if you add up all the safe loans, bottom you are going to get some sum of all the safe loans. How much it is? 0.36. So instead of giving 4 here, I give 0.36. Instead of giving risky as 3, I give 0.27. Both are same, just a different way of denoting the percentage of risky loans. Again, the prediction is same. The majority class here is safe because out of 0.27 and 0.9, 0.27 is more. And out of 0.36 and 0.27, safe loan is more. So both predictions are same. Only difference is, instead of using the numbers, I am using the proportion values. Are you clear so far?
Yes, Sandeep.
So here, what is the misclassification error? Misclassification error means percentage of misclassifications. So out of safe and risky, here I am predicting safe. What is the percentage of risky I am missing? I am missing this part. 0.09 is a misclassification in the first branch. And in the second branch, 0.27 is a misclassification. Because I am predicting safe, but there are 0.27 risky also. So plus 0.27 by how much is the overall? 0.27 plus 0.9 0.09 plus 0.36
plus 0.27
plus 0.27. What will happen is this entire thing will become 1. Why it will become 1? We are simply adding all of this. In a way, we are simply adding all of this. 1 by 11 plus 1 by 11 plus 1 by 11 plus 1 by 11, so on. We are adding all of this. So the sum will become 1. Okay. This will become 0.36. So the misclassification error that we are doing for this tree is 0.36. Now the question is, we should decrease this error. The error is something that I should decrease. How do I decrease? I should increase some weightage somehow. Somehow I have to increase the weightage of the observations where I am doing mistake. For example, when income equal to high, I am predicting safe, but risky is where I am doing a mistake. Here I am doing my mistake, right? So I have to increase the weightage for this mistake. Similarly, when income equal to low, I am doing mistakes here. This risky one, this one, this one. These three places I am doing mistake. I have to increase the weightage here. That's what I should do now after this first tree is built. Is it clear what we did so far? We did not still learn how to increase the weightage. But at least we went through the logic and understood what is the misclassification error that we are doing. This is our baseline error. This is our baseline error. We should not go below this. Sorry, we should not go above this. Our error should not increase more than this. Our error should only get decreased from this. Are you guys clear with this?
Yes.
Vijaya?
Yes, only.
Yeah. So for now, we'll take a break of 5 minutes. We'll come back and understand how to increase the weightage. Okay?
Sure, sir.
Okay, then we'll come back at 7:35. Is everyone back?
Yeah, I'm back, Sandeep.
Vijay, are you back?
Yes, I'm back.
Okay. So let's try to understand how to do it. So this is the first tree. For the first tree, what we did is we took same weightage. Weightage is nothing but I mentioned it as alpha. We took the same weightage for all the observations and try to predict. Now second weightage, there is a simple formula. I'm not going to derive or anything, but I'm going to show you how to second tree. I'm going to show you how this works. How would the weightage get increased or decreased? That is what I'm going to give you an intuition. Now, to give the second tree, we need to compute something called W. And W is given as half log 1 minus misclassification error by misclassification error. And misclassification error we already computed earlier. Earlier tree we already computed, which is nothing but 0.36. Now we use the same value and compute something called W. Half log 1 minus 0.36 by 0.36. Now what is this W? So let me compute this. Log of 1 minus 0.36 by 0.36. And one second, let me open the calculator and calculate this. This is much better. One second. One minus 0.36 by 0.36 is this value. Log of this, log means in this calculator it is showing ln. Ln means natural log. Log of this one minus this one is this one by 2. That's why we have 1/2. So it is coming around 0.28 2876. That is the value that we are getting. Now once we get this W, we have to calculate this weightage. Weightage is alpha, not W for us. So we have to calculate this alpha, and alpha is nothing but alpha nu. Or let me call it as alpha 2, is nothing but alpha 1 into e power w, or let me give it as alpha nu itself. Alpha nu equal to alpha old into e power w if prediction is wrong. And alpha nu equal to alpha old into e power minus w if prediction is correct. Just let me put this one in a box. So this is how we should calculate the new alpha. So the old alpha we already calculated as 1 by number of observations, which is 0.09. But there are places where we did mistakes. There are observations where we did mistakes. And there are observations where we did not do mistakes, where we predicted properly. So wherever we did mistakes, we have to increase the alpha value. Wherever we did not do any mistake, we should decrease the alpha value. That's what I mentioned earlier. So let's see how to do it. So alpha 2 equal to alpha 1. This is alpha 1. Alpha 1 means weightage of the first tree. Weightage of observations that we used in the first tree. Alpha 1 into e power w. W is nothing but we already got it as 0.2876. If prediction is wrong, whenever prediction is wrong, we should use this new alpha. So what is this alpha 1? Alpha 1 earlier it is always 0.009 into e power 0.2876. So what is the overall value, final value? 0.2876 into 0.09. Sorry, I'm wrong. 0.2876 e power of this. So this is e power 0.2876 into 0.09. So 0.119. I can round this off to 0.12. When prediction is wrong, earlier the weightage is 0.09. Now the new weightage is becoming 0.12. Now if prediction is right or prediction is correct, what is the alpha, new alpha value? Let me do it. Alpha 1 into e power minus 2876, because e power minus w if prediction is correct. So what is minus e? Minus 0.2876. Minus 0.2876. E power of this is going to be this into 0.067. Now earlier our weightage is 0.09. Now since the prediction is correct, I decrease the weightage to 0.06. Is that clear how I am increasing or decreasing the weightages?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's go back and try to do this for the new alpha. So when income equal to high, I predicted it as safe. All of these are safe, but there is one risky. This is where I went wrong, right? So here I have to increase the alpha. To which value I have to increase? 0.12. If prediction is wrong, I should increase my alpha to 0.12. So now, from now on, the alpha for this value, for this observation, is going to be 0.12. Earlier it is 0.09. It got increased to 0.12. Now when income equal to low, I again predicted it as safe loan, but there are some risky observations as well. These three are observations where we have risky. So in these three observations, I did some mistakes. So what I should do? When prediction is wrong, prediction is wrong, I should use 0.12. So in all these cases, I have to keep 0.12 here. These are the places where I did a mistake. Now the remaining all the variables, all the observations, I predicted properly. So when I predict properly, I should decrease the weightage. So earlier the weightage is 0.09. Now the new weightage will become 0.067. So all the other other observations will have 0.067. Okay, this is how I can convert, increase the alpha value for observations where I did properly, where I did mistakes, I should increase. And whichever observations I predicted properly, I should decrease the weightage. That's how I did. Are you guys clear, Vidya and Abid, both of you?
Yes.
You guys are clear, right?
Yeah.
Yes, Sandeep.
Now, earlier our alpha is, if you add up all the alpha values, what happened is I got a sum of 1 because I took 1 by number of observations as the alpha value. Now, if I sum up all these new alpha values, I will not get sum as 1. So what I should do is, I should always normalize my alpha value so that if you sum up all the values, I get 1. This is a standard. This is called normalizing. So what I do is I'll normalize the alpha values. How do I normalize the alpha values? One second. What I do is I take the alpha value for that value. What I do is I'll divide it by sum of all these alpha values. If I do that, what I get is some other alpha value, normalized alpha. This is what I get. I call it as normalized alpha. And this normalized alpha, if you sum up all these normalized alphas, what will happen is I'll get a sum of 1. Let's see what happens. Let me do for each of these values. Let me do it as constant, the sum. If I do that as a constant and drag this until the end, if you do the sum is going to be 1. This is only for our convenience. It is always good to have a sum of 1 because the total weightage should be always 1. It's more of our convenience. Okay, are you clear so far? Now normalized alpha. Equal to alpha I by sum of all the alphas, sigma alpha. If I do that, I'll get a normalized alpha. Are you guys clear so far?
Yes, Sandeep.
Vidya?
Yes, Sandeep.
Now I'll build another tree. Now I have a new alpha values, new weightages. Using these new weightages, I'll build the tree and try to find the predictions. Okay, I will not change the tree at all. The tree will be exactly same, only the weightages will change. Earlier weightages are like this, so based on that, I get the predictions. Now let's see the same tree. I'm not doing anything different. Income equal to high, income equal to low. Now when income equal to high, what is the weightage of safe loans and risky loans? Similarly, what is the weightage of safe loans and risky loans when income is low? Let me try to find out again. Again, I'll try to filter out income equal to high. How many safe loans are there? 3 safe loans are there, but I'm not giving 3. The reason why I did not give 3 is because of this weightage. I'll just add up these weightages this time. I'll not give 3. So when I add up all these 3 values, I got a weightage of 0.201. And how many risky loans are there? Only one is there. What is the sum of all those weightages? 0.12. Now these are the number of this is the weightage of safe loans or risky loans. What happened earlier? If you go back and see,
safe is majority.
Safe is 0.27. No, majority is fine, but 0.27 is the safe loans. 0.09 is the risky loans. Now what happened? 0.27 got reduced to 0.2.
Yes, Sandeep.
And 0.09 got increased to 0.12. This got decreased. This got increased. Wherever you are doing mistakes, that is getting increased. Wherever you are doing properly, that is getting decreased. Now let's see the other way also. What is the when income equal to low? What I should do? I should filter by income equal to low. When income equal to low, did I do wrong? I'm sorry. I did not use the normalized one, right? I'm sorry. It's my mistake. I should use the normalized weightage. So I should add up these three. Yes or no? These three I should add. This is 0.211. 0.211. And this is 0.126. 0.126. And when income is low, how many safe loans and risky loans are there? When income is low, how many safe loans are there? All these plus this one. I should add these three plus this one. I should use the normalized alpha. These four I should add. And when income is low, the number of safe loans is 0.28. The weightage of safe loans 0.28. And the percentage of our weightage of risky loans is these two plus this one. How much it is? 0.379. Now, if you go back and check, what is the prediction here? What am I going to predict here? Someone should answer this one.
Safe, Sandeep.
Safe. What I should predict here?
Risky.
Risky. But what did I predict here earlier?
Safe.
I predicted safe earlier. This one and this one, both of them I predicted safe. But here, if you see, this is 0.36, 0.27. Both are very close. These are not very close. What happened? This got reduced. This got increased. Because of that, now this will become, this is more of a risky loan than safe loan. That's what it is saying. The prediction got changed. Yes or no?
Yes, Sandeep.
Now, based on this, what I would say is, this branch is risky loan. It is incorrectly predicted as safe loan earlier. In the previous tree, we were saying it is a safe loan, but actually it is risky loan. So what boosting did is, it boosted some observations where we are going wrong. Because of that boosting of that weightages, what happened is this branch became risky loan. Are you guys clear how the predictions are changing? Let's go to tree number three. Okay. This is first tree. This is second tree. Now we'll go to third tree. First, what we should do? We should build, calculate W. What is this W? Half log. One second. Before all these things, we should calculate the misclassification error. What is misclassification error? Here we're predicting safe, but there is 1.26 of risky.
So 1.26
is my error here.
Plus 0.28.
0.28 is the error here. What is the overall value?
One.
If you add up all these things, it should be one. Very close to one is also one. Okay.
Yes, sir.
0.126 plus 0.28 is going to be 0.40. My misclassification error is 0.40. Okay. How much is my misclassification error earlier? 0.36. Now it is 0.40. Okay.
Yes, Sandeep.
It got increased.
Yeah.
So what I should do? Again, I should do boosting. I can do third tree also. Yes or no?
Yes, Sandeep.
I can start creating third tree. How do I create third tree? I should first calculate W. W equal to half log 1 minus misclassification error by misclassification error. Okay, I do the same thing. What is misclassification error? 1 minus 0.40 by 0.40. What is this logarithm? 1 minus 0.40 is 0.6 by 0.4. It is becoming 1.5. ln of this, ln means log base e. That is coming as this one by 2. So W is going to be 0.20. Now again, I have to calculate alpha nu. Alpha nu equal to alpha nu instead of saying alpha nu, alpha 3. Okay. Alpha 3 equal to alpha 2 into e power W. If prediction is wrong. So alpha 2 is what when prediction is wrong? When income equal to high, when income is high, what is alpha that is wrong? Risky is where I did wrong. Actually, I'm predicting safe, but risky is where I'm going wrong. So 0.12 is where I'm, what I'm doing wrong, right? 0.126. 0.126 into e power W is 0.20. Are you guys able to follow or not?
Yes, Sandeep.
0.20 e power of 0.20 is this one into 0.126. 0.15. 0.154 after rounding off. And alpha 3 equal to alpha 2 into e power minus W if prediction is correct, right?
Correct. Yes.
What is alpha 2 when prediction is correct? There, it is safe. I'm predicting whatever I'm predicting is also safe. So 0.07 is where I am doing 0.07 is the alpha, 0.07 into e power 0.20.
Minus 0.20, right?
Yeah, that's correct. Thanks for correcting. You're right. 0.20 minus 0.20 this one, and e power of that is 0.8 into 0.07. So what is the new alpha?
0.06057.
Let's keep.
Okay.
Three digits is fine. Three decimal points. Now actually earlier it is 0.07. Because prediction is correct, I am giving lesser weightage, 0.05. Earlier the value is 0.126 when prediction is correct, but I am increasing it to 0.54. Are you clear or not?
Yes, Sandeep.
And the prediction is correct, I am increasing. Now, again I have to build another tree. Yes or no? The next step is building another tree. Alpha 3 I have to build. How do I build alpha 3? So when income equal to high, I am predicting, what did I predict? I am predicting safe loan. When income equal to high, I am predicting safe loan. Because I am predicting safe loan, risky is where I am doing mistake. So when I am doing mistake, what is the alpha 3? When I am doing a mistake, alpha 3 is 0.154. When I am doing correctly, what is the alpha? 0.057. Here is where I am doing correctly, 0.057. This is also I am doing correctly, 0.0057. This is also I am doing correctly, 0.057. When income equal to low also, I have to fill the values. When income equal to low, what am I predicting in the previous tree? Risky is what I am predicting. So whenever I am doing safe, I am doing a mistake. Safe is where I am doing a mistake. Yes? Oh, I did a calculation mistake. I'm sorry. Did I do a calculation mistake? One second. So here I am doing a mistake actually. So when it is safe, I am also doing a mistake. Yes or no? Are you guys clear or not?
I'm clear. Yeah, it's something.
So when it is safe, I am doing a mistake. So when it is safe, what is the alpha value? 0.07. So I should also calculate 0.07 into e power 0.20. Prediction is wrong when it is safe also. This is a prediction is wrong, and it is prediction is risky. Then I am using that risky value. What is the risky value when it is risky? The value is 0.126. When it is risky, I am doing some mistake in when income is equal to high. Are you guys clear or not?
Yes or no?
When it is risky, I am doing a mistake. So that's why I calculated 0.126 into e power 0.20. That's why I got 0.154. But when it is safe, when income equal to low, when income equal to low, my mistakes are different. My mistake is when it is safe, I am doing a mistake because safe is not I am predicting. So my mistake when it is safe, when the prediction is safe, alpha 3 equal to alpha 2 into e power minus e power w if prediction is wrong, right? what is this alpha 2 when prediction is wrong in this left branch? I mean, in this income equal to low, alpha is wrong when you are predicting safe in this branch. So 0.267 into e power 20, 0.20. Again, e power 0.20, e power of this into 0.067. What is the value? Now I am increasing the value. So even if it is a prediction is safe, I am predicting as risky. Because I am predicting as risky, I should increase the risky value here. From 0.27, 0.67, I should increase to 0.08. Are you clear so far?
Yes, Sandy.
So wherever it is safe, I am doing wrong. So I should increase the weightage. Now wherever it is risky, I should decrease the value, right? Because it is right, it is correct. In the left branch, in the right branch here, wherever it is risky, it is correct. Wherever it is safe, it is wrong. In the left branch, wherever it is safe, it is correct. Wherever it is risky, it is wrong. It is just a reverse. That's why there might be a confusion. That's why I'm just worried. So when it is wrong, what happens? Alpha 3 equal to alpha 2 into e power minus w. What is alpha 2 when you are doing correct here? Risky is the correct value. What is the risky value here? 0.26. Sorry, 0.126. 0.126 into e power minus w.
Wait, are we taking alpha values or normalized alpha values?
We are always taking normalized alpha.
Because for the top one, for the safe one, you took the alpha value 0.067. Come down. When this one, yeah. That's the
alpha. Oh, okay. Then I'm doing wrong. Sorry. You're right. Thanks for that. We always take the normalized values. 0.07 in 0.20 e power of 0.20 into 0.07. It is 0.085. Okay. Thanks for correcting. You're right. I think everywhere else I took normalized, right? These are all normalized. Now 0.126 into e power minus 0.20. E power minus 0.20. This is e power of that one into 0.126. What is the value? 0.103. Okay. So this is 0.085, again 0.085. This is when it is wrong. When it is correct, it is 0.1103. 0.103. Okay, these are filled. When income equal to high, I forgot to fill some more values. I filled, I think 0.057 and 0.154. Yeah, I filled all the values. Now, if you look at it, these are the new alpha values. Wherever I am doing correct, I am decreasing the values. Wherever I am doing wrong, I am increasing the values. Again, if I sum up all these things, my sum is not going to be 1. Again, what should I do? I should normalize the values. Give me 5 more minutes. I'm already late, I know, but if I start it again, it will be late tomorrow. Just 5 more minutes, we're going to close it. Just normalizing them. If I normalize them, sum should equal to 1. That's how it is here. Okay, now I should use this value to predict the third tree. Now again, let me quickly do the third tree. Income equal to low, income equal to high. High, low, number of safe loans and risky loans here, and number of safe loans and risky loans here. Let me quickly calculate. When income equal to high, the number of safe loans, the sum of safe loans is going to be 0.175. 0.1755, and number of risky loans is 0.158. And here in this branch, number of safe loans is 3 plus this one, it is 0.349. And number of risky loans, I mean the weightage of risky loans is this one, 0.317. Okay, that's how we build the third tree again. Now how do I combine the predictions of all these three trees? Every tree is going to give some weight, right? The W is something that, this is nothing but the W that I'm giving you is nothing but it is the weight of the tree. So what I do is final prediction is a combination of weight into its prediction. So W1 into its prediction P1 plus W2 into its prediction P2 plus W3 into prediction P3. You combine all these things like this and then just take a sign of all these sign of the final value. If sign is positive, then predict safe loan. If sign is negative, predict risky loan. Are you guys clear? Multiply the weightages with the prediction. Finally, take the sign of it. If it is positive, say safe loan, otherwise risky loan. That is how boosting is done. This is ADA boost. This is called ADA boost, adaptive boosting. Any questions on this?
So why are you stopping at third tree?
I can stop at 100th tree also, because I cannot calculate more than this, I stopped it.
Oh, okay.
Very simple. I'm doing manually, right? That's why I stopped at third. You can go for fourth, fifth, as many as you want, but as long as you have a easy way to do the problem, which is a computer. Okay, any questions? So the only thing is, in ADA boost, use the classes as +1 and -1. Maybe something like this, +1 as safe loan, -1 as risky loan. encode your safe and risky loans or your classes as plus one and minus one. Only if you do that, this sign is valuable. Otherwise, how do you take a sign, right? Only if you encode your safe loan as plus one, risky loan as minus one. So your prediction is what? Finally, your prediction is safe or risky. How do you multiply your weightage to safe loan or risky loan? Instead of safe loan, use plus one. Instead of risky loan, use minus one. If you encode like this, when the sign is positive, you anyway encoded your positive as safe loan, predict as safe loan. When your sign is negative, predict as risky loan. That's how you can do. Otherwise, you cannot multiply this. Okay? Are you guys clear?
Yeah, and even in the third tree, the misclassification error is increased. So I guess, we just build the trees until the misclassification error is less than the base error and then we can stop?
We don't have to. Okay. The reason is your weightage will also be important, right? What we are doing, our prediction is nothing but weightage of the tree into the prediction. What is the weightage of this tree? 0.20. What is the weightage of the previous tree? 0.28. This is much better tree. This is a good tree compared to this tree. So based on the weightages as well, it is going to adjust itself. That's why it is adaptive tree. Are you clear? We are giving the prediction based on the weightages. Whichever is doing good, the ADA boost is going to know its weightage properly. This is 0.28. So the first tree is going to have more weightage. What about the second tree? I don't know. First tree, where did I keep? First tree. Yeah, this is the weightage of the first tree. And this is the weight of the second tree. Even though I kept it at the third tree, but actually misclassification error is the second tree, right? That's how I got. So third tree also I should give the weightage. Based on all the weightages, it's going to take the prediction, right? So ADA boost already knows the weightage of the trees, so it will adjust accordingly. You don't have to say I need 1,000 trees because my misclassification error did not decrease. It's going to adjust by itself. Now Abid has some question. If I do final prediction after building 4 trees, I got 1 prediction, and will the prediction be same if I do after 10 building 10 trees? No. After building 10 trees, your prediction will be much better. But okay. The question is, will your computer be able to build 10 trees in given amount of time? Let's say if you want to build your 10 trees in 10 minutes, if it is able to build in 10 minutes, very good. If it is not able to build, then it is a problem. You have to reduce your number of trees.
Yes, Sandeep.
Like I said, if it is building, if you are building 1,000 trees, then 1,000 trees will be much better than 100 trees. But the only question is, if building 1,000 trees takes 3 days, it is a bad model. It's not going to solve any problem. So it should be building the trees in a good amount of time. If it is taking too much amount of time, it's a bad model. That's the problem. The only problem is you can increase as many trees as you want, but the amount of time it will take is bad, is going to be increasing. And the second thing is you cannot build these trees in parallel, right? Only after building the first tree, you can use this first tree to build the second tree. Right? You cannot build the trees in parallel. So after building first tree, based on first tree, you build second tree. Based on second tree, you build third tree. That's how you can build. That is the problem with this boosting. Time, it is going to take a lot of time. Okay? Abid, are you clear with this question? I mean, the answer?
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay. So that's all I have for today. Any further questions you have?
No, I'm clear, son.
Okay then. That's all I have for today. We'll catch up tomorrow then. Bye.